Professor Dave here. I want to tell you about Edwin Hubble.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Earlier in the series, we learned about the incredible history of astronomy from ancient times all the way up until the 20th century. A tremendous amount of knowledge was gathered about the solar system in that time, and as a result, the center of our universe shifted from the Earth to the Sun, with the planets moving around in elliptical orbits. It was then realized that all the stars in the night sky are suns, just like ours, potentially with planets of their own, and this realization caused our perceived universe to grow tremendously in the blink of an eye to reveal the true scope of the Milky Way galaxy. Then, in the early 20th century, something even more incredible happened. Telescopes became powerful enough for us to see that many objects we had thought were nebulae or other such objects within our galaxy are actually not those things at all. These are entire galaxies unto themselves, just like our own Milky Way galaxy. All the billions of stars we see in the night sky turn out to belong to just one little island of stars out of hundreds of billions of similar and very distant little islands. And what we had thought was the entire universe was revealed to be just a speck of dust in a far grander structure. We didn't figure this out until the 20th century because these galaxies are just so far away. We already learned about the local group that the Milky Way is a part of, and even these closest galaxies are millions of light years away, a distance so great that the stars in our own galaxy suddenly seem a stone's throw away by comparison. It took huge, powerful modern telescopes to get images with good enough resolution to see that these were not simple structures, but rather swirling masses of many stars. And we began to categorize them as spiral galaxies, elliptical galaxies, and all the other varieties we learned about earlier in the series. One person who made considerable contributions to the task of categorizing galaxies was Edwin Hubble, and he developed the categories and subcategories we use today. But that's not all that Hubble did. He gathered data that would later allow for the interpretation that the galaxies are all moving away from one another. This was determined by looking at emission spectra for many galaxies. To understand how this is possible, we must learn about a phenomenon called the Doppler shift, or the Doppler effect. Say we have some source of waves, which could be acoustic waves, or sound, just as well as electromagnetic waves, or light. Say that these waves are emitted with a constant frequency. Now let's say that the source of these waves is in motion with respect to our frame of reference, like a car. When the car is coming towards us, the sound waves will be of a shorter wavelength than if the car was stationary. This is because the car is moving closer to us in between the emission of each wave. If the wavelength is shorter, the frequency is greater, and we will hear the sound as being pitched up. Once the car passes and is moving away, the wavelength will increase, because the car will travel some distance away from us in between the emission of each wave. A longer wavelength means a lower frequency, and we will hear the sound as being pitched down. Higher pitch coming towards us, lower pitch moving away from us, and that's why a vehicle passing by will sound like this. Precisely the same principle works with electromagnetic waves, or light. A source of visible light that is moving towards us will have its frequency increase, and the wavelength will therefore decrease towards the blue end of the visible spectrum. We call this a blue shift. If it is moving away from us, the frequency will decrease, and the wavelength will therefore increase towards the red end of the visible spectrum. We call this a red shift. These shifts are easy to observe on an emission spectrum because we know where the emission lines for hydrogen and other elements ought to be. If an object gives emission lines that are shifted from these values, it's a very clear indication of the motion of that object. When Hubble observed the emission spectra for a variety of galaxies, it became apparent that almost every single galaxy in the observable universe is redshifted, meaning they are almost all moving away from us, with the only exceptions being a handful of galaxies nearby that are gravitationally bound to the Milky Way. Rather than assuming the Milky Way is an especially repulsive galaxy that the others are fleeing from, astronomers realized that the universe itself must be expanding. If we imagine that the dots on this balloon represent galaxies, and the surface of the balloon represents the space-time fabric of the universe, as the balloon expands, all of the dots get spread apart. All of them are moving away from all the others, and no matter which dot you're standing on, all the others will appear to recede from you. If the universe is expanding, then it must have once all been very close together. This fact was the first piece of evidence that suggested the birth of the universe from a single point at some specific time in the finite past. But as if this realization wasn't shocking enough, Hubble also realized that the recession velocities of the galaxies increased with greater distance. In other words, the farther away a galaxy is, the faster it is moving away from us. This relationship is stated in Hubble's law, a very simple equation relating recession velocity, measured in kilometers per second, and distance, measured in megaparsecs, which are equivalent to 1 million parsecs, or 3.26 million light years. This equation also utilizes h, or the Hubble constant, equal to about 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec, with some dispute over its precise value. We can use this equation to find the approximate distance to any distant galaxy in megaparsecs, given its recession velocity that we can determine from the red shift in its emission spectrum. There is much more to discuss regarding Hubble's law, which we will get to a bit later. First, we want to make good on our promise from the beginning of this series. Hubble's realization that the galaxies are all receding from one another was the first observation that suggested a cosmological model like the Big Bang. But this isn't nearly enough evidence to be conclusive. So what else did we figure out to corroborate this model? Let's move forward and go over the evidence for the Big Bang. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.